Steps to life is opening God's word with you.
Jesus is coming again. Are you ready for his soon return?
Jesus Christ is always what we'll share with you.
We need a refreshing, so drink. Jesus is the water of life.
Steps to life, a work of love, a work of love.
He created this earth and wants to recreate you.
He can change your life.
Let's seek the Lord in prayer before we open His holy book and search His word. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege that we have to search Bible prophecy and to look around us and to see the prophecies being fulfilled in front of our very eyes. And we pray that you will help us now as we are seeking to understand the times in which we live and how to relate ourselves to what is going on around us. We pray that you will give us wisdom and grace to understand truth and to follow it and to be ready for the coming of Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. The research for the events that I want to describe to you was done by a friend of ours in Washington State. And it's about Adventism and the World Council of Churches, not only the World Council of Churches, but also, as we will see, Vatican II. Now, in 1958, it was only 1 year after the publication of the book Seventh-day Adventists Answer Questions on Doctrine, Pope John XXIII called for a great ecumenical council of the Roman Catholic Church. This council began in 1962. Here's what we read about it from the documents of Vatican II, quote, "The participants with full voting rights were all the bishops of the Roman Catholic Church, of both the Western and Eastern rites, superiors general of exempt religious orders, and prelates with their own special spheres of jurisdiction. Non-Catholic Christian churches and alliances and Catholic lay organizations were invited to send observers. These observers, however, had neither voice nor vote in the council deliberations." So here we have a Catholic worldwide ecumenical council, which is convened to study ecumenism, how all the churches can come together. However, the only people who have voice or vote are those who have official positions in the Roman Catholic Church itself. We read now from the Seventh-day Adventist Encyclopedia, Second Revised Edition, 1995, under the article on ecumenism, and this is what it says, quote, "Early in 1965, the World Council of Churches appointed a working group to enter into formal dialogue on matters of mutual interest and concern with a similar group to be appointed by the Secretariat, that's the Vatican Secretariat, for the promotion of Christian unity." Notice, here are various churches getting together to study matters of mutual interest and concern. We should read what Ellen White says about this in the book Great Controversy, page 445. She says, "When the leading churches of the United States, uniting upon such points of doctrine as are held by them in common, shall influence the state to enforce their decrees and to sustain their institutions, then Protestant America will have formed an image of the Roman hierarchy, and the infliction of civil penalties upon dissenters will inevitably result." What is the Seventh-day Adventist position in relation to ecumenism, the Roman Catholic Church, the World Council of Churches, and what is to be our relationship with all of these different organizations or bodies? Well, to get the answer to this, we need to understand, first of all, why did God raise up Adventism? What is the Second Advent movement, and what do Adventists believe? Why are we here? What is the message that we have to give to the world? The message that God has commissioned His Advent people, His last day people, to give to the world is the message of the three angels in Revelation 14, verses 6 to 12. The second angel's message reads as follows. Verse 8. And another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Notice, it says that Babylon has fallen and all nations have participated with her in her unlawful activities. To get a further description of Babylon, who it is and what it is, we go to Revelation, the 18th chapter, and read verses 2 to 4. It says, He cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become a habitation of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hated bird. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plagues. We will not take time to point out that in Bible prophecy, a church is symbolized commonly by a woman. And Babylon is called a woman, both in Revelation 14 and in Revelation 18 and Revelation 17, Babylon the Great is called a woman, a church. But what kind of a church is this? It is those churches that teach people to break God's law. Sin is the transgression of the law, 1 John 3:4. And it says in Revelation 18:4, I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, that is out of Babylon, my people, lest you share in her sins. Notice, sin is breaking God's law. Babylon is teaching people to sin, and if you join that communion and you share in the sin, you will also share in the plagues. And of course, the great sin of Babylon is the persistent attempt to change and to teach people to break the fourth commandment. So, Seventh-day Adventists cannot have fellowship or join up, have communion with churches that belong to the great Babylonian system. Seventh-day Adventists cannot participate in anything like communion with churches in this position unless they decide to keep all the commandments of God. The true church of Christ in the last days is described over and over again in Revelation as a church that keeps the commandments. But what has been the Seventh-day Adventist position, that is the position of the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists on ecumenism? We go again to the Seventh-day Adventist Encyclopedia, and we read, quote, The General Conference Committee has never voted an official statement regarding the Seventh-day Adventist relationship to the ecumenical movement as such. So they've never voted a position. However, they refer us to a book that was written in 1974, or published in 1974, by B.B. Beach, called Ecumenism, Boon or Bane. Now, in 1973, this same B.B. Beach co-authored a book with Lucas Vischer, Secretary of the World Council of Churches. And the title of that book was, quote, So Much in Common, or more complete with the subtitle, So Much in Common Between the World Council of Churches and the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Incidentally, it was this same B.B. Beach who in 1977 presented the Seventh-day Adventist Church in symbol on a gold medallion to Pope Paul VI. So, what really is the Seventh-day Adventist General Conference position on ecumenism? We're told that there really isn't any. None has been voted. However, as we continue reading in this article on ecumenism, in the Adventist Encyclopedia, it says, quote, Thus, while there is not exactly an official position, there are clear indications regarding the Seventh-day Adventist viewpoint. Very interesting, isn't it? There is not an official position according to this publication. The General Conference has not taken an official position, but there are clear indications regarding the Seventh-day Adventist viewpoint. Well, what are these clear indications? Then we're told something very, very interesting. Have you ever heard people say, well, it's not so critical as some of these revival preachers have talked about. It's not so critical as some of these independent Adventist preachers have talked about to be able to define exactly who and what the church is. That's not such a critical area. Have you ever heard that objection? Listen to this statement from the Seventh-day Adventist Encyclopedia. This statement has to do with your position, your personal position on ecumenism. And this is what they say, quote, "A person's attitude toward ecumenism will be determined by the individual's concept of the nature of the church." Very interesting. Your position on ecumenism will be determined by your concept of the nature of the church. Well, what are the clear indications regarding the Seventh-day Adventist viewpoint that they write about on ecumenism? And what is this attitude toward ecumenism that will be determined by a person's concept of the nature of the church? But more importantly than that, we want to know not just what is the position of the individual, but what is the Seventh-day Adventist General Conference Church leadership's concept of ecumenism and the nature of the church? We will read now from the same article on ecumenism, quoting what they say Seventh-day Adventists believe. You need to remember, when the church leadership states, quote, "Seventh-day Adventists believe," unquote, what they really mean is what the sane leadership of the church believes, of the leadership believes, and to them, that is the position of the majority of the church, and they intend to put the brakes on any members who seek to hold views divergent from the responsible leadership of the denomination, as you can read in Eternity Magazine in 1956. But this is what they say Seventh-day Adventists believe. Quote, "Seventh-day Adventists believe that all sincere Christians of whatever communion constitute the people of God." Do you believe that? That does not agree with Revelation 18, verse 4. Revelation 18, 4 says, "Come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plagues." Notice, God has a people in Babylon, but God does not leave them there. He calls them out. And he says, if you don't get out, you will share in her sins, and you will share in her plagues also. But contrary to what Revelation 18:4 says, it says in the Seventh-day Adventist Encyclopedia that Seventh-day Adventists believe that all sincere Christians of whatever communion constitute the people of God, and leadership further states, quote, "They regret that their sense of world mission makes membership in the National Council and World Council impracticable." Notice, the Seventh-day Adventist leadership regret that their sense of world mission makes membership in the National Council and the World Council impracticable. In other words, if we put it in plain English, the Seventh-day Adventist church leadership regrets that they cannot join hands with Babylon in the National Council and the World Council of Churches. This, however, is not the regret of all faithful Seventh-day Adventists. But the Seventh-day Adventist leadership wants to work in fellowship with other Christians in every way that does not involve a compromise of what they understand to be their mission as a people. Notice, under this same article in Ecumenism in the Seventh-day Adventist Encyclopedia, the following astounding statements are made. It says, back in 1926, long before ecumenism was in vogue, the General Conference Executive Committee adopted an important statement that is now a part of the General Conference working policy. This declaration has significant ecumenical implications. The concern of the statement was for the mission field and relationships with other missionary societies. However, the statement has now been broadened to deal with religious organizations in general. It affirms that Seventh-day Adventists recognize those agencies that lift up Christ before men as a part of the divine plan for evangelization of the world, and hold in high esteem Christian men and women in other communions who are engaged in winning souls to Christ. In the church's dealings with other churches, Christian courtesy, frankness, and fairness are to prevail. Now, we should indeed esteem highly every human being for whom Christ has died on the cross of Calvary. But Revelation 18:4 makes it very clear that people that are in Babylon are not to stay there. If they are God's children, they are to be called out. It says in 1926, and it says that that was long before ecumenism was in vogue, that the General Conference Executive Committee adopted an important statement that is now part of the General Conference working policy. This first sentence proves that ecumenism was the position of the Seventh-day Adventist Church leadership, not of the laymen. But the leadership has bent over backwards to assure Adventist laymen that the church has never been an official member of the National or World Council of Churches, but that the church is merely an observer of these councils of Babylon. However, the SDA Encyclopedia does say that this declaration has significant ecumenical implications. Now, they also say in this statement that this statement has now been broadened to deal with religious organizations in general. So, great ecumenical strides have been made among the Adventist leadership since 1955. Today, the World Council of Churches has as its goal not so much organizational union, we're still quoting from the Seventh-day Adventist Encyclopedia, as mutual recognition. What this means is that the different churches and denominations are to recognize each other's baptism, communion service, and ordained ministry. Notice, there are three things that the ecumenical movement wants all the different churches to recognize. They want each church to recognize the baptism of the other churches, and the communion service of the other churches, and the ordained ministry of the other churches. The problem, of course, is when you have some church ministers and ministry who are teaching people to break God's law and others who are teaching people to keep God's law, it is impossible to mix this truth and error together without a moral fall in your own church. So the churches and denominations of Babylon are to recognize each other's baptism, communion service, and ministry. Where can this lead you? Well, it can lead you to the following. A cardinal of the Roman Catholic Church chaired an ecumenical weekend entitled Baptism, Communion, and Eucharist at Union College, Nebraska, a Seventh-day Adventist church. And here's what it said in the Lincoln Journal Star, October 21, 1995. Quote, Baptism will be the theme of the Roots and Branches Convocation, Thursday through Sunday at Union College, that's a Seventh-day Adventist college, sponsored by Interchurch Ministries of Nebraska. Speakers include William Cardinal Keeler, Archbishop of Baltimore, and President of the National Conference of Catholic Bishops. The Reverend Michael Kinneman, Dean of Lexington Theological Seminary in Kentucky. And the Reverend Gail Felton of Duke University Divinity School. And Brigalia Bams, General Secretary of the South African Council of Churches. Then the newspaper says this. The event is the first in 3-year series of annual convocations for laypersons and clergy. More than 200 people from across Nebraska and around the country are expected to attend. Convocations in 1996 and 1997 will focus on communion and ministry. Together with baptism, they represent the three key ecumenical issues facing efforts at church cooperation and unity worldwide. The convocation is an opportunity for people to come together and celebrate together, worship together, talk together, enjoy together. So far as we know, he said, this is the first time anywhere this kind of thing has been done. Edward Cardinal Cassidy, president of the Vatican's Pontifical Council for Christian Unity, was scheduled to attend, but at the last minute was sent by the Pope to Romania. Monsignor John Rodano, A staff member of the Pontifical Council will attend as his representative. A worship service at 7 p.m. at College View Seventh-day Adventist Church, 3015 South 49th Street, with Cardinal Keeler speaking on baptism and the community, is open to the public. Notice it's talking about communion and ministry being together with baptism, that they represent the three key ecumenical issues facing efforts at church cooperation and unity. Now, the question needs to be asked. What do Pioneer Adventists say? What did the Pioneer Adventists say about worshiping together, talking together, praying together, and enjoying together with the fallen churches of Babylon? What did they say? We will quote what James White wrote in the Review and Herald, January 14, 1861. Here's what he says. Here is a man, for instance, who does not agree with us on the subject of the second coming of Christ. He believes that we are wholly mistaken in regard to this great truth. Can we feel at union with such a man and take him into our fellowship and communion? We cannot. We can but feel that he shuts his eyes to some of the clearest light of the Scriptures and refuses assent to their most unequivocal testimony. We cannot therefore extend to him the hand of Christian fellowship. Just so with the Sabbath. Can we fellowship with the man who violates it? We cannot. On a vital point connected with the teaching of the Word of God, we are at issue. And the union that would otherwise exist between us is, of course, destroyed. So, with the subjects of baptism, the sleep of the dead, the destruction of the wicked, etc. Where there is not agreement in theory, there can be, in the Christian sense, no real communion of heart and fellowship of feeling. Notice, James White says that we can but feel that he, that is the Christians of other churches, that they shut their eyes to some of the clearest light of the Scripture and refuse to assent to their most unequivocal testimony, and therefore, he says, where there is no agreement in theory, there can be, in the Christian sense, no real communion of heart and fellowship of feeling. So, did the Pioneer Adventists, did they believe in ecumenism? They most certainly did not. The Lincoln Star reported, so far as we know, this is the first time anywhere this kind of thing has been done. Sad to say, it was apostate Seventh-day Adventist leadership that condoned the first time anywhere this kind of thing being done. Now, we could go to much more evidence about the development of ecumenism in Adventism. Because of the ecumenical influence at the Vatican II Council, the contemporary Seventh-day Adventist Church has become involved with the World Council of Churches, and later, as we have seen, with the Roman Catholic Church. Bert Beverly Beach attended the Vatican Council II as an observer. And in 1973, he co-authored a book, So Much in Common, with the Secretary of the World Council of Churches. Now a question could be asked. What do Seventh-day Adventists have in common with the World Council of Churches? And how did Adventists ever come to the place where they thought they had something in common with the Great Assembly of the Churches of Babylon, the Harlot Daughters of Rome? In his book, Beach disclosed that the cooperation between the Seventh-day Adventist Church and the World Council of Churches really began at the Vatican Council II. Here is what is said, quote, in view of the fact that informal conversations between the World Council of Churches and the Seventh-day Adventist Church have been taking place on a regular basis for over 4 years, he's writing now in 1973, it is not inappropriate to consider the significance of these contacts and take stock of what has been accomplished so far. Well, what has happened and what had been accomplished so far by 1973? We read again from the book So Much in Common, page 98, quote, strange as it may seem, These yearly consultations are an indirect byproduct of Vatican II. In fact, while in Rome, in connection with the Vatican Council, a World Council of Churches staff member and an Adventist representative, be interesting to know who that Adventist representative was, came to the conclusion that an informal meeting of a small group of Seventh-day Adventists with an equal number of representatives from the World Council of Churches would fulfill a useful purpose. Adventists, being insufficiently informed regarding the World Council of Churches, and the World Council of Churches staff and church leaders being equally in need of additional and more comprehensive knowledge regarding the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now let's look at three of the important points in this revealing paragraph. First of all, he admits that this event was strange. Strange that four Seventh-day Adventist representatives were attending the Great Ecumenical Vatican II Council, and then he refers to a representative from the Adventist Church and the World Council of Churches, deciding that it would fulfill a useful purpose for Seventh-day Adventists and the World Council of Churches to meet. But then, more interesting than this, is the statement that these yearly consultations, that is, the consultations between the Seventh-day Adventist Church and the World Council of Churches, are an indirect byproduct of Vatican II, and that the consultations were brought about by the spirit of the Great Vatican II Council of the Roman Catholic Church. Interesting. The first meetings, it is written, were held in 1965. We're still on page 98 of So Much in Common. It says the participants being selected by the two organizers. Subsequent meetings have become somewhat more formal in the sense that the employing bodies of the SDA participants have authorized and financed their presence, and the executive committees of the three Adventist divisions involved have given their blessing by facilitating the selection of the SDA representatives. The World Council of Churches has defrayed the expenses of its group. The General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists has been kept informed regarding the meetings, though it has taken no direct active part in the consultations, except through its three European divisional branch offices. Now we'll notice quickly seven important points revealed in this statement. First of all, the participants were selected by the two organizers. So, the official Seventh-day Adventist representative was selected by some official organizer among the leadership of the Adventist Church. Number two, it is stated that subsequent meetings have become somewhat more formal. This could only mean that the leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church was becoming more involved in the consultations. And number three, the employing bodies of the SDA participants have authorized and financed their presence. So, the Seventh-day Adventist Church leadership authorized and financed the presence of these representatives at these ecumenical meetings. Did the membership know that their leadership was using tithe or free will offering funds to finance meetings with the churches of Babylon? Did the members want their funds that they had contributed to the finishing of the third angel's message to be used to consult with the fallen churches of Babylon? Was this not a grave betrayal of trust? And then number four, it says, and the executive committees of the three Adventist divisions involved have given their blessing by facilitating the selection of the SDA representatives. After the consultations became somewhat more formal, the leading man chosen as the representative for the Seventh-day Adventist Church was Dr. Earl Hilgert, professor of theology at Andrews University. Since Dr. Hilgert left the Seventh-day Adventist Church to become a Presbyterian and took a position at a Presbyterian college in Chicago, Illinois, Dr. Ryle Detterin, professor of theology at Andrews University, was chosen to succeed Dr. Hilgert as the SDA representative. And then, point number five, we are told that the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists has been kept informed regarding the meetings, so we know that the General Conference knew about the meetings and accepted them evidently without protest. By not protesting the consultations with the World Council of Churches, the General Conference was actually placing its approval upon it. and then. Point number six. It says the General Conference has taken no direct active part in the consultations except through its three European divisional branch offices. Now, one of these European division branch officers was none other than B.B. Beach himself. So, B.B. Beach would also later serve as the Secretary of the World Confessional Families, the theological branch of the World Council of Churches. And while serving as the Secretary of the World Council of Churches, he would present the Seventh-day Adventist Church in symbol on a gold medallion to Pope Paul VI in 1977, I believe. And then, the statement, November 24 to 26, 1969, the consultation was the fifth in the series. The next question, of course, is how many consultations have there been since 1969? So, what has happened in Adventism and what has happened in the other churches in the world in regard to ecumenism? Much ecumenical activity today takes place outside of the World Council of Churches on the local level in the form of unstructured interdenominational youth and lay Bible study, prayer groups, fellowships, and community service endeavors. And we see this new face of the ecumenical movement prevalent in contemporary Adventism in every one of these phases of compromise. We see it in the celebration worship services directed especially toward the youth. We see it in the watered-down outreach literature and evangelism of the contemporary denomination. And we see ecumenism in the community service endeavors. This was the reason given for merging the Adventist hospitals in Colorado with the Roman Catholic Provenant system. We see the new face of ecumenism in interchurch fellowships. Some churches have even held interchurch Super Bowl parties. We see ecumenism in lay Bible study and prayer groups. But remember what James White said? He said, on a vital point, connected with the teaching of the Word of God, we are at issue. And the union that would otherwise exist between us is, of course, destroyed. James White wrote in regard to our relationship with other denominations, and he said, quote, where there is not agreement in theory, there can be, in the Christian sense, no real communion of heart and fellowship of feeling. Well, can we conclude our study of ecumenism in the Seventh-day Adventist Church and still not realize that we have betrayed the second angel's message? If the church is going to be faithful to its commission to call people out of Babylon, out of the Sunday-keeping churches, how can we unite with the very groups that we are commissioned to call people out of? But the contemporary Seventh-day Adventist church leadership now recognizes the churches of modern Babylon as Christian brethren, and as such, quote, we recognize every agency that lifts up Christ before man as a part of the divine plan for the evangelization of the world, and we hold in high esteem the Christian men and women in other communions who are engaging in winning souls to Christ. Friends, however high esteem we may hold people who are in Babylon, our commission is to call them out, because if they stay there, they're going to burn up. But contemporary Adventist leadership has now accepted erroneous liberal Bible translations. They have accepted the false Christ of modern Babylon, that is, the false teaching that Christ possessed the human nature of Adam in the Garden of Eden before the fall. Today, SDA leadership has rejected the final atonement in heaven and replaced it with the completed and final atonement on the cross. That change has never, ever been officially refuted. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is now teaching most of the false doctrines of modern Babylon. A false Christ and a false atonement. But James White said that there could be no union. No union. Ellen White said the following in Upward Look, page 88. She said, there can be no union, no unity between truth and error. There can be no unity, no union. Well, somebody says, what about these people that have been in deception? What are we supposed to do with them? Aren't we supposed to help them? Yes, but notice what Ellen White says in Upward Look, page 88. We can unite with those who have been led into deception only when they are converted. Do you realize, friend, that it is the truth that is going to triumph? What is the truth that is going to triumph? It is the truth of the three angels' messages. Ellen White makes very, very strong statements about the three angels' messages. She says that the three angels' messages are infallible. And part of it, right in the heart of it, is the warning concerning Babylon being fallen. And the invitation then in Revelation 18 to come out of Babylon and not partake of her sins. God does not suggest that Babylon can be reformed. He says if you want to have eternal life, you have to get out. We can unite with those who have been led into deception only when they are converted. God says, Revelation 18:4, I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins and lest you receive of her plagues. Ellen White writes in the book Upward Look, page 88, the time has come when things must be called by their right names. The truth is to triumph gloriously. And those who have long been halting between two opinions must take their stand decidedly for or against the law of God. You see, that is the issue. That was the issue at the beginning of the great controversy. That will be the issue at the end. The issue is over the law of God. The devil wanted to change the law at the beginning. And he wants to change the law at the close. And you have to decide whether you're going to go along with the system that wants to change God's law and teach people to break it. Teach people that it can be changed. The truth is to triumph gloriously, and those who have long been halting between two opinions must take their stand decidedly for or against the law of God. Some will take up with theories that misinterpret the Word of God and undermine the foundation of the truth that has been firmly established point by point and sealed by the power of the Holy Spirit. The old truths are to be revived in order that the false theories that have been brought in by the enemy may be intelligently met. There can be no unity between truth and error. We can unite with those who have been led into deception only when they are converted. The Bible says, Revelation 18:4 says, to the children of God who are still in Babylon, to come out. Because if you don't come out, you're going to participate in her sins. And then you're going to share in her plagues. Ellen White says there can be no unity between truth and error. We can unite with those who have been led into deception only when they are converted. If Ellen White were alive today, having written that in Upward Look, page 88, what would she have to say about four Adventist representatives, unquote, attending the Ecumenical Vatican II Council in Rome, headed by Pope John the 23rd and Pope Paul the 6th? What would she do about Seventh-day Adventist ministers coming back from this Vatican II Council and addressing Adventist people and referring to the Pope as His Holiness? Do you know how the Bible refers to the papacy? The Bible never refers to the papacy as His Holiness. It does refer to it, though. It calls the papacy the man of lawlessness or the man of sin. And there is no agreement between sin and holiness. But Adventist ministers have come to the Adventist people describing in glowing terms how that the relations are not so icy anymore between the Seventh-day Adventist Church and the church at Rome. The question that needs to be asked in this regard is, if the relationship between the Adventist Church and the Church of Rome is better than it used to be, who changed? Here's what Ellen White says. She says, Catholicism indeed resembles much of the Protestantism that now exists because Protestantism has so greatly degenerated since the days of reformers. She writes in Great Controversy, page 571. The Roman Church now presents a fair front to the world, covering with apologies her record of horrible cruelties. She has clothed herself in Christ-like garments, but she is unchanged. Every principle of the papacy that existed in past ages exists today. The doctrines devised in the darkest ages are still held. Let none deceive themselves. The papacy that Protestants are now so ready to honor is the same that ruled the world in the days of the Reformation, when men of God stood up at the peril of their lives to expose her iniquity. She possesses the same pride, an arrogant assumption that lorded it over kings and princes and claimed the prerogatives of God. Her spirit is no less cruel and despotic now than when she crushed out human liberty and slew the saints of the Most High. Oh, friend, what do you believe? Do you believe the reports how things are so much better now than they used to, or do you believe what the Spirit of Prophecy says when she says that the change is not in Catholicism, the change is not in the papacy? They are still the same as they have always been. Their spirit is still as cruel and despotic as it ever has been. The change has been in Protestantism. Or shall we come to the point? The change has been in Adventism. The papacy, page 571 in Great Controversy. The papacy is just what prophecy declared that she would be, the apostasy of the latter times. It is a part of her policy to assume the character which will best accomplish her purpose. But beneath the variable appearance of the chameleon, she conceals the invariable venom of the serpent. Faith ought not to be kept with heretics, nor persons suspected of heresy. She declares, "Shall this power, whose record for 1,000 years is written in the blood of the saints, be now acknowledged as a part of the Church of Christ?" Oh, friend, where are we in the stream of time, and what has happened to God's professed remnant people? We were given a mission, and our mission was to take the three angels' messages to the entire world. We are to take God's last message of mercy to a dying world. And this message is not to join up with all the religious world, but it is to say, look, those people that are in Babylon, those people that are, and Babylon, of course, represents the church which has fallen because of her sins, because they will not keep the law of God or follow the teachings of the Bible. The Lord says, if you don't want to partake of her plagues, you're going to have to get out so that you don't share in her sins. But man thinks the time has changed, and now that we can fellowship with Babylon and talk things over and have inner church services together. And we see this happening now all over the country, not just in the large churches anymore, but even in the smaller places. But if you want to really be a Seventh-day Adventist, not just in name, and then end up receiving the plagues. And by the way, many Seventh-day Adventists are going to receive the plagues. You can read in Early Writings, page 71, or 19 Manuscript Releases, page 176. Many Adventists who continue in sin are going to receive the plagues. But if you really want to be a Seventh-day Adventist, not just in profession or in name, but in reality, here is some counsel from Ellen White to you. This is from Battle Creek Letters, page 52. It says, "Now and ever we are to stand as a distinct and peculiar people, free from all worldly policy, unembarrassed by confederating with those who have not wisdom to discern the claims of God so plainly set forth in His law." We are to remain a distinct people, a peculiar people. We are to be free from all worldly policy, and we are not to confederate with those who are breaking the law of God. The message is going to triumph. There's no question about that. The three angels' messages are infallible, and they will triumph, and it does not take a lot of people in the world to make them triumph, because God is behind it. That's not the question, whether the message will triumph or not. The three angels' messages cannot be overthrown. They're infallible. But there is a question. And the question is this. When the three angels' message triumphs, will you triumph with it? Those people who do not have enough moral backbone to proclaim the three angels' messages now, who say, oh, it's not time yet, those people that do not have the moral backbone to proclaim the three angels' messages. We're not talking about hate. If you really love some person that is going to be destroyed, you're going to warn them so that they will avoid destruction. The person that really has love in his heart and knows the truth will show another person what to do to avoid eternal destruction. And as you read in the last chapters of the book of Revelation, in the closing scenes of this earth's history, almost all the world is going to be deceived, and God has called Seventh-day Adventists as watchmen on the walls of Zion to declare to the religious world the meaning of the book of Revelation, the three angels' messages, what is about to happen, how to get ready for it, and how to avoid the seven last plagues. But so many people, instead of warning people to come out of Babylon, want to simply join up with Babylon in some type of an inner church service, some type of an inner church communion, some type of an inner church fellowship. They want to recognize other people's pastors, their baptism, and their communion service. Where are you going to stand? Where are you going to be? Do you see that there is a great shaking taking place today in Adventism? And everyone, before it's over, is going to have to make up his or her mind where they're going to stand. Are you going to be part of the ecumenical movement in which a large part of the Seventh-day Adventists are entering today and are involved in? Or are you going to say, no, I have to proclaim the three angels' messages. I have to be involved in the distribution of the book Great Controversy as long as it's possible. I have to be involved in inviting people to come out of Babylon so they won't share in her sins and partake of her plagues. Which is it going to be? Which is it going to be? Are you simply going to follow along with the great majority? Or are you going to say, no, if I have to stand all by myself wherever I am, I'm going to be faithful to God's Word. I am going to see that people in my area receive and hear about the three angels' messages and have an opportunity to come out of Babylon so that I do not receive of the plagues of God that will come on those that stay in Babylon and participate in her sins. The message of God, friend, is unequivocal. Read Revelation 18, verse 4. It gives no other alternative. We can either stay in spiritual Babylon because we're going to a church that is breaking God's law, teaching people to break God's law, teaching people that it can't be kept. We can stay in these Babylonian churches, these Sunday-keeping churches, or we can come out. And we can join the faithful of God, the remnant of God, who have chosen to keep His law, to keep His commandments, and who will be ready to meet Jesus at His coming. The big question is, which side will you be on? The message will triumph. There's no question about that. The message can triumph with many or few. That's not God's problem. But your problem and my problem is, when the message triumphs, where will you be? If you don't have enough courage to stand for the message now, if you do not have enough courage to distribute the three angels' messages to help other people find out the truth now, how will you stand in the future? How will you be ready when the crisis hits and when the final showdown comes and everybody in the world is lined up on one side or the other and there is tremendous pressure on both sides? If you can't stand the pressure now, you won't stand the pressure then. It's up for you, friend, to decide which side, what side of the ecumenical movement are you going to be on? Are you going to proclaim the three angels' messages? Or are you going to just join with Babylon and have a good time until the plagues befall, are falling? The answer to the question is up to you.